Hopefully you can hear me. It doesn't look like you can see me, but this is a dear posy from Beth Jacob. I want to thank everyone once again so much for joining and supporting our phenomenal series that comes to a close this evening, the three part series with Dr. Henry Abramson, which again, from the feedback that's come to us, has been universally praised as really so comprehensive, clear, and a really important window into Jewish history and really Jewish. We want to thank also our sponsors from Beth Jacob, Jerry and Madeline Eisenberg, who are commemorating the 10th Yahrzeit of Evelyn Sachs Goldstein, Esther Merl Bat Yehuda, Chaya Gittel, and the upcoming honoring the upcoming Bar Mitzvah of their grandson, Aaron Yeshaya Cohen Eisenberg, which will be on Shabbat Chanukah Rosh Chodesh. We want to also thank all the Beth Jacob members and the community members who have come to take part in this session and have been offering such valuable insight. And of course, not last but not least, thank Dr. Abramson for this is our chazaka of three times of really hot, top-notch programming that we've appreciated so much. I look forward to having our third installment this evening. And for those of you on our mailing list, we'll be able to receive the YouTube recording of all of the lectures. Two have been sent out so far, and we'll have one more coming after this lecture. So we'll be able to continue to learn going forward as well. So with that, we again thank everyone for joining, and I hand it over to Dr. Anderson.
Thank you so much, Rabbi Posey. It really is a wonderful privilege to be able to speak to you and your amazing Kehila, and I'm really grateful for the feedback. Not quite as grateful for the feedback I've gotten in the public sphere with YouTube, because there's lots of nasty people, or I shouldn't say nasty people, lots of nasty comments from people who felt either I was too liberal or too conservative. So I hope that the series makes a positive impact on how people approach these difficult questions in public discourse. By the way, the background is a little different because I am currently in transit. The Great Association for Jewish Studies Conference is taking place in Boston this weekend, or Sunday and onward, and I'm on my way to present a paper there on the Jews of Ukraine. So that's why I didn't bring my green screen with me, so that you're seeing the background of a hotel room. So here is the opening joke, which I think in many ways speaks to the deeper issues that we have been looking at in terms of questions of Jewish identity in the last two lectures, and we'll continue with today as well. It's one of my favorite jokes because it has really a tremendous amount of depth to it that's expressed in a classically Jewish manner. So the joke goes like this. There's this Jewish out-of-work actor, young man, wants to make it big in Hollywood, can't quite figure out exactly how to get his big break onto the silver screen. And one day he's reading in the trade journals that there's an audition coming up for a gorilla impersonator. And, you know, he's tired of waiting tables. And although it's not the kind of great role that he's always been hoping for, he thought, you know what, maybe this will be something anyways, better than working in a restaurant. So he goes to sign to try out for this role, and he actually gets the part. And it appears that the Los Angeles Zoo had recently lost one of its beloved gorillas. And while they're waiting for another one to arrive from Africa, they need an impersonator to, you know, take this place inside the gorilla enclosure so the zoo can keep attracting and pleasing its patrons. So, you know, he takes the job and he goes into the gorilla enclosure, and he finds that at first, although it's somewhat humiliating, he starts getting into the role. You know, he's a Stanislavski method actor, and he thrills with delight when the children squeal at his antics, and, you know, he beats his chest, and the parents are smiling, and he's actually really enjoying his new role as a gorilla impersonator. One day, when he's really deeply into the role, he's swinging from vine to vine in an unusually violent manner, and he accidentally finds that he swings right out of his enclosure and lands in the neighboring lion's den. And he gets himself up from the ground, and he looks up into the face of a ferocious lion, and he realizes, oh my gosh, this is the end of my life. You know, I'm about to be devoured by this massive feline. So because he is, after all, a good Jewish boy, and he remembers what he learned back in Cheder, that at the end of a Jew's life, he or she is supposed to pronounce the great statement of God's unity. And so he covers his eyes and he says, Shema Yisrael, Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad. You know, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And he takes his hand off his eyes, and the lion says, Baruch Shem Kavod Malchuso Le'olam Va'ed. And then from next door, the giraffe says, Shah, you'll get us all fired. I hope you enjoy that joke. It's hard to tell because I'm speaking in a you know, hotel room to a laptop right now, and I realize I've never told this joke to a blank screen, so I'm hoping you're laughing on the other end. But I think this joke is especially useful for us because it points to the degree to which Jews will manipulate the parameters of identity to learn how to adapt to the varieties of societies in which they live. In this humorous example, this out-of-work actor, you know, he impersonates a gorilla, and then he later realizes the lion is also a Jew impersonating a lion, the giraffe is also a Jew impersonating a giraffe, and so on. And this is something about the Jewish condition. We should recall that, you know, we're a minority people, with the exception of the land of Israel, and only in recent decades, you know, since the beginning of the 20th century, in the middle of the 20th century, really, we've never been a majority in any land that we lived, with the exception, of course, the ancient period. And, you know, as a minority, you're always vulnerable. You're always at the whim of larger societal forces. And one of the things that Jews have to do is to figure out how to negotiate between the extremes of assimilating into the body politic of the outside society, and on the other hand, hewing closely to the tradition, which exposes them to being so different and foreign and sometimes threatening to the societies in which they live. And so many of the stories that we've looked at over the last 2 weeks and we'll look at today also speak to that negotiation between the Scylla and Charybdis, the opposite dangers of assimilation and isolation. It's also important to note, perhaps before we get to the material itself, is that at this time of year, the December dilemma, where we have the holiday of Hanukkah, which, although, you know, it seems to be a holiday of religious freedom, and, you know, Yehuda Maccabee stands up for defending the Jewish tradition, in reality, it represents a huge Kulturkampf, a cultural struggle between the forces of assimilation, the Hellenistic Greeks who wanted to adopt the outside mores of Syrian Greek society, and the ultra-traditionalists who wanted to go back to, you know, the pre-Greek era of life in the land of Israel. And so this is a perennial dilemma that, you know, Jews experience even to this very day. But let's not get too far away from where we're supposed to be addressing our comments. Let's look specifically at the identity of the Jews of Asia. So I hope you can all see my screen all right. I'm going to focus really on two major populations of Asian Jews. We're going to look, again, this is just a 60-odd minute lecture, so it tends to be somewhat superficial, but we're going to just survey the birth and experience of the Jews of Southeast Asia, specifically India, and then we're going to look at the Jews of Eastern Asia, specifically China. There are many other Jewish pockets in all of these areas of Asia, but I think these two major sections, the subcontinent of India and the massive landmass of China, will be sufficient for us for today. So let us try to understand, how do these Jewish communities come to be? Most important element is the route of the Silk Road. This is not really one route, but actually multiple routes that essentially carried valuable goods from east to west and vice versa. In the west, which means essentially the Mediterranean basin, a tremendous desire for certain luxury goods that were produced in the Far East, like silk, which eventually would be moving further and further west in terms of its production. But the Romans in particular loved silk clothing. It was something really, as today, considered a huge luxury item that was heavily sought after. And also, this is sometimes called the Spice Road, because the India in particular, and China as well, had a tremendous number of preservatives that could be added to food to preserve the flavor and sometimes to mask the putrefaction that would occur as a result of the lack of refrigeration. So in other words, they needed spices to make food more palatable, especially because they didn't have ways of preserving foods other than smoking or pickling and things like that. So bringing things like that from the West, bringing from the West often manufactured goods, weaponry, swords, things like that. Later slaves would be a very important part of this trade. And it extends from the ancient period right up until the 15th century with the discovery of the Americas. And we should recall, of course, the whole enterprise of the attempt to discover the Americas was the attempt to find a shortcut for the Silk Road, where explorers thought, maybe rather than going in this very difficult overland route or this roundabout seaborne route where you have to hug the coast, maybe we can find a shorter way to get to India and China. And that's in fact how they bumped into South America and Mesoamerica and North America. And then everything changed after that. But have a look at this map here. You can see the major routes of the Silk Road. The Green Road is the major overland route that goes primarily through Central Asia. And to the south in particular, you have maritime routes. The maritime routes are the ones that we're going to begin with looking at the settlement of Jews in India. So what do we know about Jews following these routes? We do know that Jews were heavily involved in this trade for a very long time. And in fact, we're not going to discuss it today, but in the 9th century, Jews were considered the masters of the Silk Road, a particular group called the Radhanites that were based in southern France along the Rhone River, which is called Rhodanus in Latin, hence the name Radhanites. And they followed all of these routes and even more, because by the time you get 800 years down the road, there's a lot more trade in Northern Europe and so on. So this is something that Jews had been doing for a very long time. The major settled population of Jews was where this circle is located. This would be centered, you can see, on the city of Ctesiphon, which is in Aramaic, Mechoza, one of the most important Talmudic cities. And this is the major center of Talmudic Babylonian Jewry. There's definitely Jews living in the land of Israel. There are Jews living in Egypt and in Asia Minor. But the beating center of Jewish spiritual intellectual life was really in this region of southern Mesopotamia, where the Tigris and Euphrates rivers come to spill into the Persian Gulf. And this is, as you can see, smack on the trade route of the Silk Road. So Jews were right at the very heart of it in this region early on. How we know Jews are traveling it, for the many different archaeological pieces of evidence, one of the most fascinating, I think, was discovered by this Hungarian man, Aral Stein, who was one of the most brilliant archaeologists of the early 20th century. He and his family were Hungarian Jews, although they belonged to a particular group of Jews that were very popular in much of Western Europe until the Holocaust, really, who believed actively in assimilating. They believed that assimilation to Western norms was the ideal. And so although this was not a route that his parents and his sister took, he and his brother actively chose to convert to Lutheranism because they felt that was the ultimate sort of like evolution of Jews in European society, was to fit in as much as possible. At any rate, brilliant archaeologist and a linguist, and he did some fantastic studies along the Silk Route. One of the things he discovered along the way, about midpoint, was this massive trove of documents, kind of a library that was secreted halfway along the route. Documents in a slew of different ancient languages that were used, left behind by various travelers going back and forth along the route. And included in this trove was this particular document here, a beautiful folded, carefully folded document, which was a slicha. It's a section of a prayer for the holiday of Rosh Hashanah. And it dates from the 8th or possibly the 9th century. So in other words, you can imagine this in its actual original usage. Here's a Jew who is traveling for business along the Silk Road. He knows he is going to be caught somewhere along this road, this long journey, over Yontov. And so he brings along with him a precious handwritten sitter. Maybe he had the entire davening there. Maybe he only had this one leaf. But he knew that when Rosh Hashanah came around in his own personally maintained calendar, he would stop and he would meditate upon the slicha and he would pour out his heart to God. So it's just a beautiful physical representation of what it must have been like for these Jews traveling along this lonely road and making their peace with God at the same time. So we definitely know Jews were traveling along the Silk Road in the middle of nowhere, Central Asia. This is where this turns up. That's where we get evidence of Jews actually making their way along the route. So let's have a look, though, at the maritime part of the Silk Road first. And specifically, we're going to look at how Jews ended up in the subcontinent of India. And there are multiple populations there that are all representative of various groups that made landfall here and decided to stay because the trade was so profitable. So you have in this circle here at the bottom, the so-called Cochin Jews. They live on the southern coast of India. You'll recall in the first lecture when we talked about Benjamin of Tudela, another great medieval traveler, although centuries after this Central Asian story, he referred to the black Jews of this part of the world. And in fact, I'll show you a picture later where they definitely do look darker skinned, to be sure. Then you have the so-called B'nai Yisrael, who are a little further north along the course, centered in the city of Mumbai. Then you have Baghdadi Jews in the region of Kolkata. And they come quite a bit later. They're primarily 19th century Jews moving in that region. And you have also the Paradesi on the east coast of India. We won't get to those today, but we'll look very briefly at the Cochin Jews and at the Jews of Mumbai as well. So we don't have a really good sense of exactly when the Jews first appeared in Cochin. Legends, of course, place it back in the very distant past. Legends of Jews making it there after the destruction of the temple and the first Roman-Jewish war and so on, very hard to date them with any degree of historical accuracy. We do know, however, some fascinating things, that there are Sanskrit and Tamil terms that come from India that are located in Tanakh, various goods and spices and precious stones and things like that. Appear in the Hebrew Bible, and these are words that clearly were used in southern India at this time. So definitely there is long-standing trade between the region and the ancient land of Israel. Examples like Solomon's gold from Ophir, one scholarly opinion holds that perhaps this mysterious location was in fact a place at the mouth of the Indus River, which would have been in the northwestern part of India. Quite fascinating, maybe more beyond our point here. And as I mentioned earlier, the Radhanites, it's not surprising because Jews would likely have been making landfall here with many other international traders as they had historically, and they would they would be distinguished for it as you get all the way into the 9th century. One of the most fascinating artifacts of the earliest period of Cochin Jewry is this remarkable looking copper plate, which exists intact And I can't possibly read it. It is written in the Malayalam language, and to make it more difficult, in the Vatteluttu script. Personally, I can never read anything in the Vatteluttu script. I can only read it in the old, Times Roman script, because otherwise, I don't know if you're laughing. I'm enjoying this. But at any rate, what is this strange copper document? I mean, it's made on a sheet of copper. It is it purports to be a charter to the Cochin Jews from a local king. It's not dated, but it most likely comes from the 11th century. It's amazing, the year 1000. That goes so far back. Charters are actually a very common medieval phenomenon in Europe, where Jewish communities would receive documents from the king that would outline their privileges and their responsibilities for living in a particular location. And these things were connected to something called Magdeburg Recht, where Jews would have the right to, maintain certain monopolies, the right to protect themselves with a wall around their community, and all kinds of different things. And this appears to be in that same family of ideas. It praises the Jews and one particular leader for visionary understanding of how they could live happily in this land. And in fact, the Jews of this part of the world claim that they experience no anti-Semitism, which is hard to believe, but it's actually something that's far more common in Southeast Asia and in Asia than you would find in Western Europe. The many fascinating customs that they have in India include, for example, this beautiful custom that a bride's skirt would later be incorporated into the parochas, like the special ceremonial dress of a bride would then be actually used as a kind of a covering for the Torah in the synagogue. A very beautiful kind of connection of the elevation of the dignity of woman and its connection to the protection of the Torah. Beautiful things. Also customs that on Friday evening, they would have a kind of a shamus go around, kind of like a functionary that's going to go around and light candles on the outsides of the homes of Jews to let them know that the Sabbath is coming and to provide light for the streets and so on, things like that. You can see that there's a sort of an oil lamp sticking out of the doorway there in this particular house. Really unusual customs that you don't see elsewhere in the Jewish world. By the time you get to the 13th, 14th, 15th century in particular, that's when you begin to see the Portuguese showing up. Here is a depiction of the Jews of Malabar that were described by Benjamin of Tudela. We spoke in the first class as black Jews. And in fact, here they do look more dark-skinned in this particular representation. Jews were especially associated with the Portuguese landfall in the southern part of India. Portugal, of course, was one of the early maritime seafaring countries that took advantage of this international trade to great advantage. And Jews were frequently employed as translators. Not necessarily that they would end up knowing the local language. This was true not only in the Far East, but also in the Americas. Some of the very first people to get off Columbus's boats were Jewish translators or Jewish translators who had been converted to Christianity. And they would walk out there and speak to the local population and try every single language they could think of until they finally were able to create some sort of common vocabulary. So one of these great Portuguese Jewish translators was someone who later took the name Gaspar da Gama after his patron, Vasco da Gama. And he was actually a Jewish guy who spent a lot of time in south of India as the primary go-between between the Portuguese colonialists and the indigenous population there. Certainly helped to promote the Jewish community. They have some fascinating things there, like these conical synagogues, really unusual synagogue architecture you don't see elsewhere in the world. And they have this famous synagogue in Cochin that actually has a Hebrew clock that includes Hebrew, Roman, and Indian numbers on it. This is the Hebrew side shown here. So that's just a very quick look at the Cochin Jews in particular. If you move up the coast a little bit, you have in the region of Mumbai, the B'nai Yisrael, totally different group of Jews. They do not regard themselves as being ethnically connected to the southern Indian Jews in Cochin. This is a beautiful 19th century representation of the baking of matzah by the B'nai Yisrael. I believe the language used here, besides the obvious Hebrew parts of it, I believe this is Marathi. And it's interesting to me that they're doing these things either on the floor or very close to the floor, but nevertheless, they're going through the whole processes. And on the very bottom right, after they finish it, the woman on the right there, she's just marking up the prices way beyond what you really should be paying for matzah. And that's, of course, a very time-honored tradition among Jews. That's also a joke, you know, but anyways. We don't know exactly when these B'nai Yisrael began, just like we don't know when the Cochin Jews began. The B'nai Yisrael don't have a similar document like the copper plates, but there are definitely lots and lots of evidence of their presence by the time we get to the medieval period. So these are very ancient Jewish communities that go back, you know, at least 800, 1200 possibly years. And unlike the Cochin Jews, they developed their own traditions of rabbinic leadership, sometimes quite distinct from the customs and manners of what we would consider mainstream rabbinic rulers as well. And to a certain degree, you wonder how much connection both of these populations had with the Talmudic tradition, because in many cases, it seems rather tenuous. But when you get to the 19th century, there is this renaissance that occurs, particularly among the B'nai Yisrael, also noted among the Cochin Jews, that once they encounter Christian missionaries, that seems to spur a whole new renaissance and interest in Jewish identity, Jewish history, Hebrew, and so on. It's as if these people are like kindling, just waiting for someone to set them on fire, and then all of a sudden they become incredibly enthusiastic. To a certain degree, it's sort of it must be disappointing for the Christian missionaries who come and figure that perhaps they're going to win lots of converts to Christianity, and they certainly do win some, but all of a sudden the community gets so energized and says, wait a second, we should think about this. If we're Jewish, we don't know that much about our Judaism. So let's find out and let's start learning Hebrew and let's start reading Tanakh and start developing more of our skills in rabbinic literature and so on and so forth. We saw this happening in Africa as well. It's kind of an unusual phenomenon that I think bears greater meditation. So there's a huge resurgence of interest in Judaism among the B'nai Yisrael in late 19th century. Ultimately, a huge number of them would make Aliyah and constitute a distinct population in the land of Israel. They also have fascinating customs such as the hanging on the doorpost of like rice leaves and things like that, right next to the mezuzah, which is intended as kind of an auspicious sort of physical prayer for fecundity. But as you see here in this image, there's definitely, it's a very dynamic and changing society. As they're discovering more and about their Judaism, they're also discovering more and more of their secular identities too. In this picture, which is obviously multi-generational, you can see some rather very different styles of clothing represented between the older generation and the younger generation, with the young man in the center really looking essentially like a dapper European individual, where his father clearly looks like he comes from a distinct Asian culture. This is a society that was undergoing remarkable change as they began to explore their Jewish identity. So that's just a quick look at two of the most significant and quite old communities of Jews in Asia. Let's have a look at the Jews of China now, who I find particularly fascinating. So there's no question that the Jews reached the Far East along the Silk Road. We know that Benjamin of Tudela, although he probably didn't get this far himself, described Jews making their way all the way out to East Asia. And we have the Radhanites, who also traded all the way out here. And we can track specific communities in many locations. If you look at the numbers next to or underneath the names of these locations, that refers to the century in which we know that the community was established. On the far left in China, you have Khotan. That's where Oral Stein discovered the tefillah, the slicha, if I remember correctly. That's already the 9th century. And then further to the east, you've got on the coast places like Canton, also from the 9th century. But you also have to go all the way to the north, Harbin. That's actually a very important population of Jews that was established in the very early 20th century, primarily because, in fact, if only by this much that I miss personally growing up in Harbin, because the reason why this community had an explosion of Jewish settlement in the year 1904 was because the Russians were locked in a quixotic and desperate battle against the Japanese. And remarkably, even though you think of Russia geographically, it's this massive country, 1/6 of the Earth's landmass is Russia, fighting against this tiny little series of islands called Japan. And Japan would ultimately win that war, the war of 04-05, the Russo-Japanese War. And my Zaidi, Alav HaShalom, my grandfather, did not want to get conscripted into the Russian army to fight the Japanese. So he ended up, you know, volunteering to be a farmer in northern Canada. And that's how he ended up bringing the Abramson clan all the way over to these shores. But the many Jews, approximately 30,000 Jewish men, were shipped off to Harbin, and they actually ended up staying. They actually found that perhaps it was the local cuisine, I don't know, but they ended up bringing their wives by and setting up a Jewish community. So there's actually a 20th century Jewish community that was established there that, you know, absolutely fascinating in its origin. So that's a modern Jewish community, and clearly an import primarily from Lithuania and Belarus, but the rest of these communities are more medieval in origin. I think one of the most fascinating stories of the Chinese Jews has to do with their discovery, because they were largely cut off, like Indian Jews, even more so than Indian Jews, they're largely cut off from the dominant intellectual life of Jewry to the West. Such a, you know, huge gap of a geographic distance to be spanned. They never had the same kind of connection with the give and take of the Talmudic codification, and then the development of the codes and Maimonides. They were largely cut off from most of that. And in fact, they essentially lived their own lives quite distinct from the rest of world Jewry until they were discovered by the Jesuits. So Matteo Ricci, shown here, was a Catholic who was on a mission to convert the Chinese to Catholicism. And when he came to China, he ultimately, there were Jesuits who connected with a particular Jew named Aitian in the year 1605. And, you know, the Jesuits were quite fascinated that here's a guy, a Chinese guy who claims to be Jewish. And they tell a funny story about their first encounter, that apparently Matteo Ricci had this interview with Aitian, and he brought him into his apartment or his church. I'm not sure who they are. And Aitian, this Chinese Jewish guy, sees a picture of the Madonna and child, not this particular image, but I just chose it to illustrate it. And Etienne looks at it and he says, oh, isn't that nice? That looks like it must be Rivka, Yaakov, and Esav. Must be Rebecca, Jacob, and Esau. And then he shows him a picture of the four evangelists, right? Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the authors of the Gospels, or the people to whom the Gospels are attributed. And Etienne apparently said, oh, this is so interesting. Where are the other eight sons of Jacob? Assuming this was a depiction of four of Jacob's sons. So Matteo Ricci was really quite fascinated with the idea that there was these Jews out there. So they sent Jesuits out to meet with the Jewish community in Kaifeng. This is one of the most important of the medieval Jewish centers. And when they got there, they were especially interested. They wanted to have a look at the Torah scrolls that belonged to the Jewish community, because they had this strange idea, 17th century Jesuitical idea, that the original Torah scrolls had to have some kind of reference to Jesus in them. Never mind the fact that, you know, the composition of the Torah was, you know, centuries and centuries before Jesus lived. This is a way of Christian thinking of prefigurement, that texts in the Hebrew scriptures, later ones like Isaiah, for example, for sure, but even earlier ones like Genesis, are all packed with codes that explain the life of Jesus later. And so they were certain that there must be even more explicit references to Jesus in the Torah, but that the text had been corrupted by Jews who wanted to hide those things. But if they went to China and they thought that perhaps the Chinese Jews were actually pre-exilic, meaning maybe they got to China with the Babylonian exile or maybe the Assyrian exile, from either 600 or 700 years before the Common Era, they were positive that if they could look at these Chinese Torah scrolls, they would discover that Jesus was in there. They were wrong. They didn't find anything like that, but they did find Torah scrolls. They found beautiful synagogues. These are actual drawings from Jesuits who visited the Chinese synagogues of Kaifeng in the 17th century. Gorgeous, you know, multi-pillared institutions with all kinds of fascinating and rather different architecture than you'd find in the West. And also this amazing picture of Chinese Jews with the top knots and the whole thing, reading from a Sephardic style Torah that, you know, unlike the Ashkenazim who keep the Torah in cloth coverings and lay it flat on the table, the Sephardim put the Torah upright in these sort of spherical or conical boxes that then they open up like doors while they stand upright on a table, and then they're read while standing like that. And this could be, you know, Sephardic guys reading a Torah scroll, but they clearly are Asian. So they brought back all this amazing information of these Jewish communities thriving in the central China. Really quite fascinating. Now, what about their Judaism? It definitely was pretty funky compared to the Judaism that you'd find in, let's say, Germany around the same time. And the dates are difficult to establish with clarity. One of the oldest artifacts of the Chinese Jewish community in Kaifeng in particular dates to 1489. And these are stelae, meaning like big obelisks that have writing on them that talk about the nature of the community. And these stelae talk about, you know, the people who donated money to build the synagogue, because this is another example of how traditional Jewish communities are, that you're always going to find plaques. In fact, some of the oldest surviving archaeological evidence that we have from synagogues all around the world, well over 2,000 years old, are plaques that say so-and-so donated the Aron Kodesh, so-and-so sponsored Kiddush last week, maybe not quite that extreme, but you definitely have plaques that specifically name who gave money in order to support the community. This is a very, very old tradition, older than gefilte fish by far. And the Chinese have it as well. So in their stelae from 1489 and then repeated later on that, they clearly have a reference to the rebuilding of their synagogues after a few natural disasters that places them squarely within the Jewish tradition. They also have a memorial book that lists the famous names of many important Jews. And unlike Western society, in Asian society at this time, last names were assigned and only certain names could be used by people of certain stature. And many of the Jews actually had some of the most, high quality names, like Zhu, which apparently means golden and indicates that the emperor himself was pleased with them. We can say three basic things about this group, which I think is quite important. Let me just make sure I remember each of them. Yes, right. The first one is that, they're not exactly practicing rabbinic Judaism the way we would necessarily recognize all of it. A lot of it seems definitely, moving in a different direction. But they are extremely proud of their attention and fidelity to Jewish tradition when they have concrete knowledge of it. For example, they are referred to by other Chinese as Tiao Jin Jiao. I have no idea if I pronounced that correctly or not. The group that excises the sinew, which is a reference, of course, to a passage in the Book of Bereishis, which we just read, about how, you remember when Jacob is wrestling with the mysterious angelic being, and he's wounded in the thigh. And then the Torah says that, therefore, Jews do not eat the gid hanasheh, the sinew, the sciatic nerve, to this very day. And that's, in fact, what the Chinese Jews were doing when they would, slaughter a cow. They would practice nikur, they would remove that particular sinew. Or like Ashkenazim, they would simply sell that part of the animal away, and they would not even try because it can be very difficult to practice it. So even though a lot of the Jewish things they're doing don't seem to be, comporting with mainstream Judaism, they nevertheless were very, very proud of their tradition. Secondly, like the joke that we began our discussion with today, they attempted to adapt to Chinese society and its idiosyncrasies in some fascinating ways. For example, Chinese society has a tremendous amount of importance placed on external demonstrations of respect. And one of those is the famous kowtow, where you would literally lie down, fully prostrate yourself on the ground multiple times, knocking your forehead on the ground as a sign of obeisance before the emperor. And one of the emperors was fond of placing his name at the top of one of these obelisks. And since he couldn't be everywhere all the time, he ordered that people should bow down to his name on a rock. And this is, if you know anything about Judaism, this is totally forbidden for Jews. Jews are not allowed to bow down before any kind of, inanimate object. That's just too close to idolatry. So it would be too aggressive a move to refuse to bow down before this symbolic representation of the emperor. So what the Chinese Jews did is they would write the Shema prayer, actually from the joke that we talked about, they would write the Shema prayer on the top of the obelisk over the emperor's name. And then the way they would justify it is that they were bowing down to God and that great statement of God's unity. It happens also on the way. The emperor's name is there, and what he doesn't know won't bother him. That's kind of like an amusing adaptation to the necessities of Chinese culture. But they definitely were assimilating heavily. And in the 20th century, under communism, they basically disappear. They certainly had, many sort of stop gaps against assimilation, which failed in multiple ways. They would dress differently. They were known sometimes as the Blue Caps, but that may have also referred to Muslims as well. There are 50 million Chinese Muslims, by the way, 50 million of them. Let's remember that there are about 15 million Jews, 15, right? So I have never, ever met a Chinese Muslim, although, of course, we read about them. They're famous, or it's, you know, they're known for the degree to which they are currently persecuted in contemporary China. But it just gives you a sense of how few Jews there are in the world. Also, they frowned upon intermarriage with non-Jewish women. In particular, they would call them daughters of Adam, meaning they were like regular women as opposed to daughters of Israel, Jewish women. But nevertheless, it was considered, it became inevitable, and they did assimilate very heavily through intermarriage in the 20th century in particular. Their Torah scrolls were among the last thing to go. In the 20th century, they actually began selling their Torah scrolls because the community in Kaifeng was really just way too desperate. And these were distributed around the world. There are some at the Royal Ontario Museum in Toronto. And they indicate that the scribal arts were slowly slipping as well among the Chinese. But nevertheless, fascinating community that strove under very, very difficult circumstances, so far from the centers of world Jewry, to hang on to their identity. And so this brings me to a close, really, not only of this particular lecture, but of the three lectures as a whole. You know, we this time of year, when we're deep in the December dilemma, as I began our discussion with today, it's a time that I personally like to reflect on the question of Jewish identity. And the stories of these tiny Jewish communities who were, you know, isolated for centuries from the rest of the Jewish world, and were nevertheless able to hang on to even tiny scraps of their Jewish identity until they could, like long-lost tributaries, finally make their way back to the raging torrent of the main current of the Jewish population. It's inspirational to think about them and think about how they held on to their identities under unusually difficult and such diverse circumstances. So I take a lot of personal inspiration from thinking about them. And I'm very grateful to you, Beth Jacob, and Rabbi Posey in particular, and the sponsors for inviting me to give this series. And with that, I will conclude for the evening. I thank you very much for your attention. And we have about 10 minutes for any last questions or discussion.
Thank you so much, Dr. Abramson. First of all, I will just let you know that I did get your jokes, and at least in our house, we were laughing. So you don't have to worry about your blank screen. I wanted to, similar to your just recap, ask sort of a recap kind of question, which is sort of lessons learned, specifically about things like attrition and assimilation that you noted a couple of times over the course of tonight and others as well. For me, actually, I was reading this question that got emailed to me, and what popped into my head is that picture of that multi-generational family, which we've seen in America in many of our contemporary experiences where you see generations, you know, having the type of attrition. Are there these trends that you're seeing, you know, from your perspective, looking at so many different cultures, including the ones that we discussed here, and lessons that we can think about of places that maybe have been able to have stronger keys to strengthening tradition over different generations?
Wow, those are hard questions, Rabbi. And, you know, I spent most of my graduate training in the history department. The prophecy department was down the hall, and I tried to avoid those people. But I think that there are a few things that we can definitely see that are valuable. Like, for example, we looked very briefly last week at the Pew report of the 2020 that tracked attitudes among American Jews. And certain features, you know, have us tearing our hair out and worried about the future of American Jewry. Marshall Sklar, the great sociologist, once referred to the Jews as the ever-dying people, because we're constantly worried about assimilation, and we've been worried about it for hundreds of years, but nevertheless, we never seem to totally assimilate. And I think one of the things that we can take away from that is that although it's important to bear this sense of urgency, that things really do matter, things really are important, we should not necessarily be paralyzed and react negatively to innovation. Like, for example, the traditional synagogue model of membership that developed largely over the last couple of centuries, maybe last three centuries, primarily in Europe and America, the kind of membership-based dues-paying synagogue institutions that allowed American Jewry to build these massive constructions. You know, they had, as they like to say, an edifice complex. But they're changing so much because millennials don't like, you know, being trapped into memberships. They don't like working at the same job for longer than 2 or 3 years either. They think very, very differently. That doesn't necessarily mean that we can't adapt and construct new ways of connecting that still keep the Jewish community even more vibrant by bringing in people from geographically further away with the use of modern technology, like we're doing right now, actually. So one sort of takeaway lesson that I get is, you know, take it seriously. You know, a sense of urgency is important, but do not be terrified of innovation. Another sort of takeaway lesson that I get from this, and this is really from Rabbi Beryl Wine, very, very influential, popular historian in the Orthodox world in particular, who observed that one of the, Jews can do all kinds of weird things over the centuries. There's so many wacky Jewish experiments that go nowhere, and we kind of laugh about them centuries later. But there's only really one thing that is so far gone that when Jews start doing this, they eventually disappear from the rest of the Jewish story. And that is when we mess around too much with the question of who is a Jew. Groups that made decisions about counting people in, contravening the basic principles that had been adopted, you know, not as ancient necessarily as we'd like to think, but nevertheless very well established principles like the matrilineal descent principle. Once we start messing around with that kind of germ cell idea of Judaism, that's a huge danger sign. And I worry about that in America, because that is something that has happened in this country as well. We can disagree with ourselves and kind of like a big, crazy, dysfunctional family. But once we start saying that, no, you know, I can disagree with you, but you're not really Jewish, that changes things in a very, very dangerous way for group survival. And I think we've got to figure out a way to come back to center on that issue as well. So the two very quick observations, in my humble opinion.
Thank you so much. But one interesting question that was just sent to me is there any constant in terms of language? Do we see Hebrew or other types of language across a lot of the, again, the question is about tonight and the Jews of Asia, but is Hebrew a constant across some of these Jewish communities that we've seen in these surveys? Yeah.
So actually, as part of my preparation for tonight, I was very fortunate. I watched a video by Rabbi Pupko, who is a rabbi in New York City, and he gave a lecture yesterday, which is on YouTube. You can easily watch it now at the Parkey Synagogue on the Jews of China. And I said, great, I will get so many fantastic ideas. And in fact, the material that I discussed tonight about Harbin was largely as a result of his family history that goes back to that particular place. But most of his presentation was really 20th century, whereas I was really wanted to focus on origins of type issues. At any rate, One of the things that he offered in his lecture was that in order for a Jewish community to survive, it doesn't have to be widespread Hebrew literacy, but you need to have at least one person who can read Hebrew. When you lose the rabbi, when you lose someone who is kind of like the keeper of the flame, knowing, okay, this is what it says in the Torah, and I can read it to you, and I can understand it, and I can explain it. You have to have at least one person like that. What he derives from his analysis of the Chinese situation in the 20th century is that once they lost anyone who could read Hebrew, the community completely disintegrated. And I think that there's a lot of value in that particular point. I forgot to mention one kind of amusing thing, by the way. When, you know, the Chinese community was in decline for centuries. And even when Matteo Ricci's Jesuits went to Kaifeng and they met with the rabbi there, the rabbis there, they'd never met anyone Christian. Christian was something totally new to them. There were no Christians in China until the Jesuits arrived. So they're having a schmooze with this Jesuit, and they're impressed, saying, wow, this guy really knows Tanakh. He knows all these stories, David HaMelech and stuff like that. And at a certain point, the elderly rabbi says to him, listen, maybe you would like to be our rabbi after I retire. He suggests to the Jesuit, he says, wow, I think you would make a great rabbi. The only thing is, you definitely have to be circumcised and you have to stop eating pork. Those two things, and you'd be fantastic. You know, you could take my shtela. He turned him down. But nevertheless, the value of Hebrew, it may not be something that everyone has to have, but someone has to have it. And that's the way Rabbi Pupko analyzes it. And I think there's a lot of value in that.
That's fascinating. Really interesting. With that, I think we'll close. Once again, thank you to the Eisenberg family for sponsoring. And over and over again, we want to just reiterate our thanks to Dr. Abramson for a wonderful series of lectures. I look forward to connecting post our Chazaka Bezrat Hashem and learning well together. And just again, I know it's late for you, so a very, very good night on your end. And thank you so much for joining.
Thank you all very much. I appreciate the opportunity. Have a good night.